Dr. Ranjani Parthasarathy is a professor in the Department of Information, Science and Technology, Anna University. Her area of specialization is computer architecture and networks. One of her special interests is Indian language technology systems. She is actively involved in research in all the areas and has over 50 publications to her credit. She has about 25 years of experience covering both industry and academics.
Welcome to the UGC lecture series in computer science. We're looking at a series of lectures on computer networks. We're looking at the network layer, and we've been looking at the IP protocol and the routing protocols that are used in networks. What we'll be looking at today will be end-to-end routing in IP. That is, we'll look at companion protocols to IP, the use of autonomous systems and border gateway protocol, and also the address resolution protocol. So if you look at early internet topology, in the early days, the internet contained only one backbone, the ARPANET, and other networks had a single point of attachment. So the ARPANET backbone routers could know everything about the topology. So you had a picture like this. You had the ARPANET backbone, and then you had different networks which you just connect to this ARPANET backbone. So it was the responsibility of the backbone to make sure that you are able to connect from any of these regional networks or local networks to other networks. So, having a single point of contact in this sense was useful because the network was manageable, it was a small network. But as the network has grown, now we are in a situation that looks like this today. So, if you look at today's internet scenario, you don't have just one single backbone service provider, but there are multiple backbone service providers, and you have large corporations which connect to more than one service provider. And these backbone service providers, again, they talk to each other through what is called as a peering point. And there are many different internet service providers who we call as consumer ISPs. They connect to these peering points and they take the services of the backbone service providers in order to provide their services. And these consumer ISPs now in turn provide support for large corporations and small corporations. So this is the kind of scenario that we have today. So given that we have a much more complex network scenario, the idea of going from one node on some network to another node on some other network basically requires a lot more coordination between these various entities that are out here. So if you look at how the entire network is therefore organized today, we have this concept called autonomous systems. That is, we say that the entire internet we say is divided into autonomous systems. So you have an autonomous system which would have its own routers and its own different networks which are there. You can look at an autonomous system as being within one single administrative domain. And you have many such autonomous systems being connected to one another. Okay? So if you go back to this picture over here, you could say this large corporation SILF would be one autonomous system. The consumer ISP would be another autonomous system. Consumer ISP connected to multiple smaller corporations could be one autonomous system and so on. So you can look at different autonomous systems being interconnected with one another. So you can look at it as one more level of hierarchy that we can imagine. That is, we say that you have different autonomous systems. Within autonomous systems, you have different networks which are connected by means of routers and so on. And this now what you have is within an autonomous system, because it is within one administrative domain, you can have your own routing protocol to go from one network to another network within that autonomous system. But how do I go from one autonomous system to another autonomous system? So we have devices called border gateways which are used to connect up these devices to these different autonomous systems. And we also need a protocol which will allow us to go from one autonomous system to another autonomous system. Each autonomous system normally is given some unique identifier so that you are able to identify which autonomous system you need to go into. So again, coming back to our autonomous system concept overlaid on the internet structure that we just saw. Now we talk about autonomous systems as being of three different types. We have a stub autonomous system, transit autonomous system, and a multi-homed autonomous system. A multi-homed autonomous system is one which connects to different autonomous systems, right? And a stub autonomous system is something which just connects at only one point to another autonomous system. That is, it is not connected to two different autonomous systems, two or more autonomous systems. If you look at a transit AS is definitely connected to more than one autonomous system, and it also agrees to carry traffic meant for some other autonomous system. So that is, it will agree to carry traffic in transit. That is, from one autonomous system, it will carry traffic meant for another autonomous system. Stub autonomous system, on the other hand, is not going to carry traffic meant for anybody else because it is after all a stub. It is only connected to one other autonomous system. Okay. So, if you take this large corporation for instance, this could be a stub autonomous system. So, it will just take the services from a backbone service provider, but it is not going to carry traffic meant for some other backbone service provider. Now, this large corporation on the other hand, it is a multi-homed AS because it is connected to two different service providers, and these service providers themselves are autonomous systems and they would act as transit autonomous systems because they are going to carry traffic meant for other autonomous systems through that particular autonomous system and give it to some other autonomous system. Okay? So, we have this concept of multi-homed AS, transit AS and a stub AS. Now, given that we have these different types of autonomous systems, let us look at how the packets will have to be routed between these autonomous systems. So, as I just said, we have to talk about two different routing domains. One is you have to talk about routing packets between autonomous systems and then within autonomous systems. So, between autonomous systems, we refer to this routing as inter-domain routing. The autonomous systems are also referred to as domains. So, we call this as inter-domain routing, and you have protocols like EGP, BGP and so on which are used here. EGP stands for Exterior Gateway Protocol, BGP stands for Border Gateway Protocol and so on. Similarly, within autonomous systems, it is called as intra-domain routing. We have already looked at routing protocols which are used in this context. We have looked at the RIP routing protocol, the OSPF routing protocol, which makes basically make use of the distance vector routing and the link state routing mechanisms. So, what we need to now look at is the BGP protocol, which will tell you how packets can be routed between autonomous systems. So, if you look at the border gateway protocol, now this is a standard for routing between AS on the internet, and the idea here is reachability. That is, you are concerned with reaching one autonomous system, reaching different networks, not trying to get optimal routes, and that is the way the BGP has been designed. So, what the BGP routers basically do is they advertise reachability and not cost. Okay? So, reachability is what is more important here because we are looking at how I can reach different autonomous systems. Now, why is optimality not the goal? Why is it that we are not looking at cost instead of looking only at reachability? The primary reason is that the internet is too large and complex, and each autonomous system has its own notion of cost and metrics, right? So, how do you kind of compare 1 millisecond with 2 minutes or 2 kgs or something like that? So, capacity and availability of inter AS routes may not be known. Now, this is the reason why when I look at, and if I am trying to consider also inter AS routes or intra AS routes to come up with a complete route between any source to any destination, it would become too complex to handle. So, we are kind of trying to handle this problem of scale basically, that when you have more and more number of networks being connected, by providing some kind of a flexibility in the routing mechanism, and which is why the border gateway protocol just worries about how I reach a network and leaves the optimality of routing within the network to the autonomous system to choose its own intra-domain routing protocol, so that within that network it can find the shortest route or the best path that can be taken to go to a destination. Okay. So, coming to some of the details of this BGP protocol, let us look at how the BGP protocol basically operates. Now, here traffic between AS must pass through a gateway router. So, the AS chooses which routers will be gateways. That is the first step. Second, each AS autonomous system chooses one or more BGP routers as a speaker for that AS. Now, the speaker is the one who is responsible for advertising information about the networks which are there in that particular autonomous system. So, the BGP speakers between connected ASs will exchange routing information. Okay? So, look at what kind of information is exchanged. So, the BGP speakers advertise complete routes, and reliable communication is used by making use of the TCP protocol. Now, an AS may choose not to advertise some routes even though they exist, because it does not want to disclose certain routes. That is also possible. Lastly, speakers must propagate this learned information, this routing information, to other routers inside the AS. So, this is basically how the BGP operates. That is, the speakers exchange information, they collect the information and pass it on to the other routers which are there within that autonomous system. Okay? So, this is the idea. So, what is the information that they advertise and how is it that they learn this information is what we need to understand. Okay? So, if you look at the BGP route, this is what they would look like. For instance, BGP always advertises complete paths to a network. For example, If you say destination 203.154.16 can be reached through autonomous systems 143, 203, 168 and 501, then all these four have to be specified as the complete route that is taken to reach this destination. So your BGP advertisements will consist of this kind of information: destination followed by the complete route that is taken to reach that particular destination. Now, the use of this complete paths helps in avoiding routing loops, because you will have a complete path information, you can make sure that you don't end up in a loop that is there in your path. Now, coming to the BGP routes, when a router receives a new destination from a neighboring autonomous system, he will add the neighbor autonomous system to the route and store it. And he will pass that information on to the other routers, to the other BGP routers when it is passing the information. Now, the routers may also send withdrawn route messages to tell other routers to delete a route that is no longer usable. It's possible that some particular network is no longer there in that autonomous system. So, you will have to withdraw that network from that already advertised information. So, instead of sending all the information all over again, you have the flexibility of just withdrawing certain routes that have already been advertised. So, this is how BGP routes are sent and stored in the different routers. Now, at the routers, the routers can also do something called aggregation of routes. So, if you look at how this is done, the routers basically will combine routes to reduce the amount of route information that they must store and pass on to other networks. Okay, in fact, they must store. They would use this information to do the routing in a more efficient manner. Now, you can look at how this is done. So, for example, if I have a set of destinations like 203.154.82/24, 83/24, 84/24 and 85/24, you can see that these are all actually network addresses which are kind of adjacent to each other, and if all of them have the same route AS40, AS60, then they can all be aggregated as one single destination address as 203.154.82/22. AS40, AS60. The route is AS40, AS60. Here you can see that the /24 here for these four different networks has been aggregated as a single network address as 203.154.82, and you say a /22 indicating that only the 22 bits now will be used to identify the network portion. So, those 22 bits are, if those 22 bits correspond to this particular value, then you know that the route to be taken is AS40, AS60. So, this kind of aggregation is done in order to reduce the amount of routing information. You can see that when you have so many different autonomous systems passing a lot of information, this kind of aggregation will definitely help in terms of reducing the amount of information that needs to be stored at the routers. Now, reducing the information is important because you have to consult this routing table every time that you are passing a packet around. So, reducing the amount that needs to be searched or consulted definitely helps. Okay. So, an example now, a quick example on this BGP protocol. So, let's say for instance, I have a small network here. This is just for our understanding. So, I have a backbone network AS1 connected to two different networks AS2 and AS3, which in turn are connected to different customers. So, customer P, Q, R and S. Okay. So, AS4, AS5, AS6 and AS7. Now, we need to look at how the advertisements are sent by each of these autonomous systems and how that information can be passed on to all the other autonomous systems, so that each of them can then choose a path to go from any source to any destination. Let's look at what the information that we send by each of the speakers. Now, you have a speaker that will be there for each of these autonomous systems. Okay. So, autonomous system 4 and autonomous system 5, which basically correspond to customers P and Q, have a certain set of networks attached to them. So, let's say customer P has the addresses 128.96 and customer Q and 192.4.2, and customer Q has addresses 192.4.3 and 4.4 as his addresses. Now, this information would have been sent by these two autonomous systems to this autonomous system 2. So, speaker for AS2 now knows that these addresses can be reached through AS4 and AS5. Right. So, network 128.96/16 and 192.4.2/23 and 192.4.4/24 can be reached from AS2. So, this information AS2 will now advertise to AS1. So, the speaker for that will be given to AS1. Right. So, the speaker for the backbone now will advertise that this particular route can be reached through AS1 and AS2. So you'll say that network 128.96.16, 192.4.2/23, and 192.4.4/24 can be reached along the path AS1, AS2. Okay. So you can see that similarly, AS3 when it reaches that information will pass that to AS6 and AS7, saying that these networks can be now reached through AS3, AS1 and AS2. Okay. So this way, when this customer S receives this information, he has got the complete path that is to be taken to go to 128.96, for instance, to any of these networks. So once you have a complete path, then each of these autonomous systems can decide how exactly they are going to send these packets and through which ASs they are going to send these packets. Now you will find that sometimes you may have multiple networks that are available, that multiple paths may be available. So you have a choice in terms of choosing which path you want depending on certain policy decisions that you may have. Okay. So typically what is done is in with the BGP routing protocol in place, if you look at a scenario like this, say I have a campus network which is connected to a service provider network, which is connected to a regional backbone network, and which is then connected to an internet global backbone. So now what you have is, you can see that most routers do not know most of the routes on the internet. Okay. So what they will do is they will use an idea of a default route or a default router. That is, a router can use a default route to a smarter router for unknown routes. That is, you can see what's happening here. Within the campus network, they will be running some routing protocol. So they will all know how to reach one another from within this network, right? But all other networks, this router need not keep all the information of how to reach all the other networks. Instead, all it will do is it will send it to a default router, which in turn will know how to reach other networks. Okay. So for instance, this campus network, this route here, this is the default route for the campus network to say that other than the addresses which are here, I just send it to this router, and this router will take care of sending it to other routers. So similarly, each service provider network will have its own default route to reach a backbone network. So it will know how to reach certain networks which are there within this network. Outside of this network, all those will be sent to through a default route, which will go to a regional backbone network and so on. So a router basically will use a default route for unknown routes. Okay. So you can see that this concept, when it's combined with the BGP protocol and the local routing protocols, allows us to have limited amount of information at the routers, but still provide the complete reachability that is required. Okay. So the internet backbone routers on the other hand, these global backbone routers on the other hand, they cannot have a default. Okay. They must know how to reach every network. So that's the information that is stored by these backbone routers. So now the next question that comes up is, now the BGP speakers learn routes to other networks by talking with BGP speakers from other AS. How do the other routers on the same AS learn these routes? Okay, so that's, we know how, that from one AS to another AS, we have passed on the information. So BGP speakers have got this information. So how do I make sure that other routers which are there within that autonomous system get this information is something that we need to figure out. This is normally done with the help of what is called as an interior border gateway protocol. That is, the BGP routes in the same AS autonomous system can use what is called as a interior border gateway protocol to synchronize their routing data with the speaker. Okay. Now this interior border gateway protocol may also be used with other interior routing algorithms to find the best route within the AS to reach a BGP gateway. And the autonomous system administrator normally assigns a preference to other AS used by BGP to choose between multiple routes to a destination. So, as I just said, the autonomous system administrator can use different policies and come up with a preference to say that to go to a particular AS, this is the particular BGP router that will be used. Okay. So this policy based routing is something which is useful in the BGP protocol. You can see that, you can see have different policies of this nature. So BGP, for instance, the AS could say that I will accept traffic from AS 20 for delivery to AS 30. Okay, that is, we are looking at the policy that is there at AS 10. AS 10 could say, I will accept traffic from AS 20 for delivery to AS 30. I will not accept traffic for delivery to AS 40. And you can say AS 30 has a preference value of 5 for route decisions, and AS 20 has a preference value of 20 for doing certain route decisions. So these kind of policies that each autonomous system can have, it can figure out what is the path that we take, path to be taken to send a packet from a source to a destination. When you have this kind of an autonomous routing with different policies, the routing could also be non-symmetric. That is, many times we find that when two hosts communicate over the internet, the path of the packets from A to B is not the same as the path of the packets from B to A. Now, why does this happen? Again, you can see that this is related to different routing policies that are used and also related to different ISPs that you may be connected to. So, multiple backbone at autonomous system is one reason. One reason is that the endpoints connect to different backbone providers. So, each AS has its own notion of the best route. Okay, so when you are going from A to B, you could be following a different path, and going from B to A, you may be following a different path. These things become possible when you are in this kind of a policy based AS interconnection scenario. Now, coming to the overall routing picture, okay, from a source to the default router on its network is the first step. And when a source wants to send packet to a destination, what will it do? It will send it to the default router on its network. Then, from router to router to router, it goes on till the destination network is reached. Now, to go from router to router to router, already protocols like BGP, OSPF and RAP have already helped to set up the routing tables, and that information is used. Now, from the destination router to the destination node, again now you need to send the packet, right? This is the overall routing picture. Okay? So, the question that we have here is basically now this last mile problem. We know now to go from one node to on a network to a destination node on a destination network, we have the complete set of protocols in place. Now, we have to actually send the packet to that final destination. How is that done? What we call as the last mile problem. So, how does the router at the destination network identify the node that has the destination address, or the other way around, how does the source node identify the router? We said that the source node will send it to its default router. It will have the IP address of the router to which it needs to be sent. But how does it know the hardware address, and how does it actually pass it to that router? That is something we need to know. That is, we only have IP addresses, not the MAC address of the machine. So, we need to map the IP address to the MAC address so that layer 2 protocol that you have can actually deliver the packet. So, we need to have a mechanism for this. So, what we use for this purpose is called as a protocol called the address resolution protocol, ARP as it is referred to. Okay? Now, where does this ARP figure in? It figures in the link layer, or you can say it comes somewhere between the network layer and the link layer, because it is something which allows you to map IP addresses to MAC layer addresses. IP addresses to MAC layer addresses mapping is done by a protocol called the address resolution protocol. Similarly, we also have a reverse address resolution protocol which does the reverse mapping. So, we will just take a look at these protocols briefly. ARP and RARP, if you look at them, the problem is that internet is based on IP addresses, whereas data link protocols are based on Ethernet, FDDI and ATM, which have different MAC addresses. So, these two protocols, ARP and RAP, will perform the translation between IP addresses and MAC layer addresses. ARP says, given an IP address, tell me what is the MAC layer address. Okay? So, it says, I know what your IP address is, I do not know what your MAC layer address is, so please give me your MAC layer address. RARP on the other hand says, I know what my MAC address is, I do not know what my IP address is, so please give me what my IP address is. Right? So, these are two protocols used in two different contexts. In the current context, we are basically looking at the ARP protocol, because I have the IP address of a router to that I need to send the packet to, or the router knows the IP address of a destination that needs to send a packet to, but it does not know the MAC layer address. So, we need to look at the ARP protocol to understand this end-to-end routing mechanism. Okay. So, let us look at how the translation is done with ARP. What the ARP packet basically, ARP protocol basically does is, it sends out an ARP request message. That is, the node looking for this information broadcasts an ARP request to all the stations on the network. Okay? For instance, if this particular node here wants to know the MAC address of the machine, of this machine, right, which is 128.143.71.1, it knows the IP address. So, it says, what is the MAC address of 128.143.71.1? This is the information which it broadcasts on the network. Okay? And this broadcast is done using a link layer broadcast mechanism. So, it will reach all the nodes which are there over here, and each of these nodes will look at that and identify the IP address. Now, all of them know what their IP addresses are. So, the router which finds that it is its IP address which is being asked for in the ARP request, that will send an ARP reply and send it to the node which requested it. So, it say my MAC address is whatever number it has, so some 00 colon E0 whatever, that MAC address is passed on the ARP reply and that is sent back to the source which requested that information. So, ARP request and ARP replies, this is the mechanism that is used for getting this information. Now, an ARP request and reply is sent in a, has a particular packet format which will consist of the source hardware address, source protocol address, target hardware address and the target protocol address. Those are the main things that we need to have. And of course, there are some additional bytes here which will tell you what kind of hardware address is being used or what kind of protocol addresses are being used. Okay. So, if you look at an example request and see what it looks like. An ARP request will be something like this. It will say source hardware address, my hardware address is this. Source protocol address, my IP address is this. I want to know what is the target hardware address for this target protocol address. For this target IP address, I want to know what the hardware address is. So, the hardware address field in this request message will be all zeros. The reply which comes in will say source hardware address is whatever is its address, right? This is the one now that is a source. So, it says this is my source address, this is the source protocol address, right, 188.128.143.137.1, he is the fellow who is replying now. So, he puts that information in the source address, puts his address in the source hardware address and says the target hardware address is the one from which it received the request. So, 00 colon A0 colon whatever and the target protocol address is this. So, this information if you look at, when this information is exchanged between the two nodes, both the nodes now have information about their respective IP addresses and their MAC layer addresses. So, with this information, now you can pass the pass the packet to the MAC layer. The MAC layer will take care of passing it on to the correct destination node. Okay. And when you exchange this information, you also store it in what is called as an ARP cache. Okay. So, since sending an ARP request reply for each datagram would be inefficient, hosts maintain a cache called the ARP cache of the current entries. Now, note that if you have already sent a particular packet, it is quite likely that many packets are going to go from a particular source to a particular destination. So, you do not have to be sending ARP requests and replies again and again. So, if you have a reply that you have already got, it is stored in the cache, but you do not store it for too long a period of time because there may be some changes in the IP address. So, you store it for a certain amount of time, some TTL, some time to live is associated with this information and you store it in the ARP cache. Normally, you have ARP TTL timeouts of about 20 minutes. So, the contents of the ARP cache should be something like this. You will have mappings between IP address and the corresponding MAC address. IP address, MAC address, this is the kind of information that is stored in the ARP cache. So, typically what the node would do is, the moment it gets an IP address, it will check the ARP cache. It will see if the address is already there in the ARP cache. If it is there in the ARP cache, then it takes the corresponding MAC address from there. Otherwise, it will get the MAC address using the ARP protocol and then send the packet to the corresponding destination. Okay. Now, this is just a quick overview of how the entire processing will take place within a network device driver. So, you will have a packet coming in through the Ethernet, right. So, if it is a IP packet, you will identify it as an IP packet and put it in the queue. If you need to send it somewhere, you will look at the destination address first. Right, and see whether it is a multicast or a broadcast and you will see whether the destination is on the local IP address. Then you need to get the ARP so that you will run ARP so you get the MAC layer address and then send it on the Ethernet mechanism or in the Ethernet network that you have. So, this is basically what we do in order to make sure that you are able to send the packet to the final destination. Okay. So, to summarize, what we have looked at today are issues that are there in end-to-end routing. So, one is we looked at how to go from one autonomous system to another autonomous system through what are called as border gateway protocols and we saw that how the border gateway protocol basically makes use of policy based routing. And then to identify how you can map IP addresses to hardware addresses so that you can actually reach the final destination node or to go from to get the link layer mapping to the IP addresses, we also looked at how the ARP protocol is used. A set of questions as usual so that you can review the material. Question number 1, what is an autonomous system? Question number 2, what are the 3 types of autonomous systems? Question number 3, what information is sent from one AS to another? Question number 4, who sends the information? Question number 5, how does the BGP protocol avoid loops? Question number 6, why is ARP needed? Thank you.